Thank you. to think that he learned all that right in this school, right here. That's amazing.
Yeah.
The program that they have going on here.
That's funny. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is my guest, and he went to that school. Bryan Pezzone. That's how you pronounce your name, isn't it?
You know, that's how I grew up with it, Pezzone. And then I, out in the hair, a couple conductors started to say, why don't you pronounce it Pezzone, like they do in Italy? So the first time, I said, wait, I got to call my dad and ask him if that's okay.
what did your dad say?
He said, yeah, that's the way it's supposed to be pronounced, Pezzone. So people know me as Pezzone out here. And then from back east, when I went to school, they know me as Pezzone. It's all okay.
You know, I'm so relieved to hear that it's all okay. And I'm serious because I've had some people, you know, before, like with names that you could pronounce different ways, get really pissed off. And I'm like, why? I'm not sure what's behind.
You know, we started talking about philosophy.
Yeah.
And boy, if you want me to dive into the philosophy of identity, I could do that right away.
Really? Is that a big one for you?
Well, it's huge. Yeah, I think it informs everybody and their worldview. Yeah.
Yeah.
What identifies us? I mean, a name can identify us.
Yeah.
If we're hooked on that particular name, if we're not, then we identify with something else. I mean, I see it as sort of like terraces of, or concentric rings of identity, from the small eye to the big eye to the transcendent eye.
Yeah, that's so true. I remember at the beginning of this pandemic, I heard about a woman who was a violinist in an orchestra, and she was totally lost when everything hit because she was a violinist in the orchestra. Right. That was what she identified with, you know. And she didn't, apparently she didn't, you know, that was her beingness, you know. So that must be a really difficult thing to let go of, you know.
Yeah, well, you know, I just thought of this image, Cathy. You know, if you look at sort of from the beginning of the late 19th century, early 20th century, you know, you have all of these paths that musicians and artists could walk down. And so what I see when I look, I just had this image, when I look backwards with the pandemic, it's sort of like all of these multiple streams and directions became valid and became something to pursue. And they also got funded. And through their funding, they became legitimate paths to specialize in to some extent or other. And so people found themselves there. And then you put COVID happens, and it suddenly pushes a pause button on, oh, this is the whole geological strata of what has arisen as a combination of multi-aesthetics and also the economics of being able to be, you know, a specific kind of musicians, or more of a musician that does a variety of things. That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, that is interesting.
Just saw that image. I went, oh, okay. It is hard. I know a lot of people that are, some are hanging in there the best they can and playing, and others are, other friends of mine are being entrepreneurish and making the best of it. And so, yeah, we've all had to make our adjustments.
Yeah. And, I think the most bothered I am, which is interesting, is, you know, today we're on lockdown. So today for 3 weeks, And I think this is the most bothered I've been kind of on a consistent level, because I'm just totally hurting for the business people who it's affecting. And I'm just really pissed off at the governor. And, you know, and it's just LA County. It's not even Pasadena or Long Beach or Orange County or Ventura County, which are right next to us. It's just LA County. And it's just, really sad.
I didn't know Pasadena was a part of LA County.
Yeah.
And it's just down the street from me. So maybe, yeah, that's, I don't know. All I know is what I've seen. See, I don't have a TV. I'll pick and choose the news so that I'm not, that the outlets don't do me.
Yeah.
I'll pick what I want to see, and yeah. I can dose it. And
yeah.
When I see Dr. Fauci talking about the surge on the surge, you know, I go, well, I'm not sure how people are handling it, and I can't, it's hard for me to question, at least at the state level.
Well, it's hard at any level. I mean, because nobody really knows. I mean, people might, you know, kind of be gung-ho about an opinion they have, but really, we don't know, you know. And, you know, we could be sitting here with five other people who all have varying opinions and have those opinions because they've heard different things. And who knows which is right? There's nothing to help us out there.
If you bring up a good point of distinction, you know, when you talk about the business people, because, you know, there's again, I'm kind of in a spectral mode of thinking today, but there's more or less, we can say, the pure artist or the artist that just played. But there are a lot of links in the chain for us to get out there and to be heard, and or for us to be able to do our thing. And those are a number of people that dedicate themselves passionately to build clubs, to keep venues going, to keep organizations going. And and they're able to straddle, you know, their worlds of being advocates for the arts and exposure, as well as being artists themselves. And you're right. I feel bad for them. They're in a very a compromised position.
Yeah. I mean, I feel, I won't go deeply into it. Cause
yeah. Well, especially in LA, I mean, my gosh, I think that I always, in LA, I always had this idea that if you look at this, just the acreage of the LA area, and if, you know, and it's basically, it's flat. So you just see these, you know, in Century City and downtown LA and Long Beach or whatever, you see little city centers, but you don't see an island like New York. And so we have such a spread out number of artists that have done and do so many different things that I've always thought of it as the largest sort of so-called city in the world that has the most condensation of talent and variety, but in a way separated from each other by, you know, a few more miles, you know, and so that this is happening in LA County to hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of artists and musicians is its own phenomena, you know, that has its own challenges, you know, as opposed to London and New York, you know, pit work and on Broadway, etc. So,
yeah. Have you been working during this period of time?
No, you know, I have. My gosh, I just for fun, because I'm really good friends with Jim Walker, and I played, you know, the great Mike Garson, also, you know, play with Jim and when Mike would go on tour with Smashing Pumpkins or Bowie. Jim would have me sub, and then I did a lot of years just me and Jim doing my tunes and
wow.
Yeah, Mike's great. I love Mike. He's fantastic. But Jim, besides really, really helping me in the business in my early years, he turned me on to the greatest tax guy. and he's expensive, but he's worth it. And I found out the second reason why. The first reason he's worth it was that I didn't have to worry about my taxes all year. I just wrote down numbers, sent him things, and he's a wizard. He's stealth. I would get, I wouldn't be dinged too hard. So there was the intangible of the of what I was paying for was not having to stress out over getting the taxes together. And then when the pandemic hit, my good friend, and I wouldn't have done this, but my good friend, Julia Gray, who might be watching, she kind of rode me a couple times. She said, Bryan, apply for unemployment. And so I'm convinced that it was a slam dunk with the state because of how my tax guy has prepared the taxes so professionally and so thoroughly, because you have to present that to them. So when they see that, they go, oh my God, here's an essential worker, legitimate, here's this studio, this orchestra, this thing, that school, that boom, 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 boom. So there was never a problem jumping on the unemployment train. So that's what I've mostly been doing. Exclusively, and a lot of us musicians doing extra work on the side, but that's really just have been supplemental, and it hasn't been primary.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, what about creative projects?
Well, I got to tell you, Cathy, this is the mixed blessing of this whole period of time. 6 years ago, when things, I don't know how frank to get here or not, when things were changing on the political level, I decided I didn't want to use my Facebook page to engage in fist fights.
That's a good idea. I like that idea.
The internet and the social networking, it just became another version of road rage.
True.
I put a bunch of opinions up there, and people would come in, and I'd watch friends attacking each other that didn't know each other, and they were going into, F you, blah, blah, blah. I go, you know what? I'm going to start playing live piano to Facebook instead of, put opinion up there. And I actually started doing that about 5 or 6 years ago. So in the middle of gigging and whatever, when I would come home, I'd say, well, I feel like playing this piece. I feel like playing this piece. And I realized that people really liked it. And I realized that it gave me, even though it's just Facebook, I wanted the most immediate way of reaching people that was the simplest way. So it's low tech, the image is reversed, and I've explained that to a lot of people. It's because I use a Droid rather than an iPhone, and also because I don't want to do any pre-preparation. I certainly don't want to pre-record and then broadcast. I want it to be live and improvised. So what happened is when the pandemic started and I started receiving unemployment, and I suddenly, my whole life, has been a combination of improvising and reading music from doing things, in different, sort of an array of improvised situations to performing and learning and playing and with Boulez and on the other end of the spectrum, and traveling to Europe with John Adams, et cetera. I was grateful for the state for getting that support. And so I started playing more and more and more and more and more Facebook Live every single day. And I started to make more friends across the country. And I started to see these groups pop up that were Facebook music groups, you know, and we got, I know a lot of friends on here, like my friend, Bryan Nolan, who I met through the live.
He's here, by the way.
Yeah, hi, Bryan. And my, you know, my friend Erica Robbins turned me onto that page. And she was a, still is, or administrator at UCLA, and then another person would tell me about another page. So I started to jump onto about 7 or 8 pages and invite my friends, and I would cross-pollinate administrators, and sometimes I would spend all day playing one song, doing it 7 different ways to each different group, and then just because I could. But the question, I mean, the question my whole life has always been and still is, where do you fit, Bryan, musically? And what are your aspirations and why? So I've gone down a lot of paths, you know, even from student days to post that, I mean, both down, you know, hardcore, you know, 20th century composition paths, Tanglewood, classical piano, playing with Jim Walker, you know, being in the studios for a lot of years, teaching at Cal Arts, quitting the Hollywood Bowl. And now I'm affiliated with the Los Angeles College of Music because they needed a goofball that, you know, sort of could do everything. And I was recommended, but I do very little with them right now because it's all online. And the one class that I was teaching, I wasn't able to do it on Zoom because it, what I had this class do was a, it was a small ensemble class with rhythm section, a couple other people. I would have them, as opposed to giving them charts and say, okay, this is the way we're going to do a chart. I said, we're going to make up our own music. And so from week to week, you know, the, you know, bass player might find a lick and I'd go to the board and I'd write it down. And then it would be hands-on and I'd go write something else down. And then at the end of those 10 weeks, you have a showcase. So every showcase was completely different for every elective ensemble. And I really enjoyed doing that, but we had to shut that down. So when the school opens its doors back up, I'll be back in there doing elective ensembles. But the whole mindset of being with a group of students and being with a group of musicians and allowing that process to bake naturally as they share ideas. And, you know, and the personalities are different. Some personalities are very strong and saying, no, I want it to go this way. Other personalities are, I'll fit in this way. And moving the energy and having and creating, despite the personalities and despite their level, creating a really safe creative space for them to create their own pieces, you know, and then at the end of 10 weeks, be able to perform them. It was really, really, really gratifying. So that was a surprise to me.
That's really nice.
Yeah.
I can understand that. And I actually want to listen to, I want to go and listen here to some of your spontaneous combustions.
Yeah. I don't know if you've chosen some, but there's hundreds and thousands I don't even know about because I don't worry about saving things.
But they're there. Yeah. What is Toby's bringing up curbside entertainment?
Oh, that's Jennifer Biggs Walton's venture. She's a good friend of mine, and she goes out there, and she has a whole thing where she brings music to your neighborhood. And she's a violinist, and she has friends that play with her and do a variety of music, some classical, some pop, and attracts the audience from the neighborhood, and some other people travel to hear the concerts. So I don't think we can do it now with this 20-day lockdown, but Jennifer is extremely enterprising and energetic, and so goes all over town and any part of town, anybody that wants to host one of these events and puts together a nice program for them. That
sounds fun. Yeah. Well, I think this is a good moment to, well, first of all, I just want to tell you, Rita Drake says hello.
Hi, Rita.
Joyce Glasgow, Toby, Brian, I told you, Veronica Ebert, she's in Australia.
In Australia, she's great.
Leilani Carino.
Oh, she's a new friend of mine. See her? Her responsivity is fantastic to the music.
I don't know if you ever knew Marty Jabara, his pianist.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
yep,
yeah.
He's here.
Hi, Marty. He comes in once in a while when I get down, you know, because I'll post some things, you know, and I'll go through rarefactions of mood. You know, there'll be times I'm more well-adjusted to what is, and there are other times I'm just really bumming on life, going, why? You know, why did, and Marty will come in and give me a nice pep talk. And we worked together years ago. I love Marty. Thanks, Marty.
I know. He and I are good friends from the past.
Yeah.
So your spontaneous things are on YouTube, right?
Well, they're all on Facebook, really.
Oh, they are.
Because people encourage me to go to YouTube, but again, that requires other kind of work. So I would have to take everything on Facebook, move it over to a YouTube channel, establish a YouTube presence, and as soon as I thought about the work involved in that, I just went, nah. Well, maybe I'll do it sometime or when I get, you know, I'll have somebody else do it, you know. But in the meantime, you can go into.
Well, here's one right here.
I just did this one today, and it's this is this interesting one. Is this the first one today?
Good morning,
good. Yeah, what I wanted to do within the bleak midwinter, this was basically today I woke up and I said, we're on the cusp of December. And in the bleak midwinter is a traditional Christmas carol written by Gustav Holst's melody and words. And I had an approach that I wanted to take with it today, which was, you know, I don't want the melody to sort of stay bound to 4-4 or anything, but I do want a sort of constant undertone, a ripple of maybe constant eighth notes. And however the measures come out, they come out, whether they're 9-8, 5-8, 7-8, 12-8, 4-4. And then there's a couple of moments near the end where, you know, it kind of migrates to a few jazz chords, but mostly remains pantonal for the most part. So this is from this morning, and it was just a really kind of an easy flowing feeling, but I really like this idea of not having it sort of bound to a bar line or a meter. Yeah.
Will you mind if I stop halfway or something?
I don't mind at all. You know, in the beginning jiggles a little bit because it when I listened on playback, I was like, what happens sometimes is I have my phone connected to Wi-Fi, so I have more reliable reception. But the first verse kind of, you know, does the digital thing.
Should I start halfway into the song to the end, or should I start at the beginning?
Well, you know, it's only for a few measures. Why don't you can start. Start in a little bit, because I talk, you know, I talk in front of all these things, and you know, when you see myself, okay, that's where it jiggles.
I see. Okay. Yeah. All right. Here we go.
After that, it's okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Same shirt. Hey, you still there? Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, that's okay.
You had a lot of people complimenting you.
Oh, that's sweet.
You're quite beautiful.
Yeah, that's the mood I woke up in today. I mean, there's... And I was thinking that if you wanted to, there's some stuff that I did 3 days ago that was just, you know, there's a couple pages there that are avant-garde free jazz and free improvisation that there'll be some things I'll do, and I'll just share to those pages on my wall and not the other pages. So it's like, you know, it's around the periphery. I think the whole, I don't know when this was. It wasn't too long ago. You know, it's kind of, I'll say something like, oh yeah, I did that last week. And when in fact, it was probably just Saturday. You know, I started playing something, you know, really abstract and pissed off. No, it was Friday. I know exactly why it was Friday.
So you know what you were pissed off about.
Yeah, because I woke up and I played We Three Kings and this very gnarly kind of style, and then I went to pre-record for a church. I went to visit my friend Pat White, and suddenly I had this African rhythm going inside of me because I played Low Like a Rose There Blooming, and I started doing, and I did a whole like Low Like a Rose There Blooming between drumming and playing in this African rhythm and improvising. And then at night I went real dark into a very modal, slow O Come, O Come, Emmanuel that was in, you know, in Mysterium. So that was the progression of Friday. And so what I was saying to you was that this period of time, I've been wishing, for the last 10 to 15 years that I could have a midlife break from just the constant rotisserie of getting in the car and going and doing this, doing that, doing this, doing that, doing this, doing that. And what's really gotten clear is that being able to do this on a daily basis, two or three times a day, maybe taking... Definitely, the only time I'll take a break for football, or Pittsburgh Steelers especially.
Okay.
I was kind of pulling for Brady yesterday, really, from Boston. But, you know, and a little as a sideline, people ask me about holidays. I don't really celebrate holidays, but I just tell them, when the Steelers are in the Super Bowl, that's a holiday.
That's a holiday for you.
Yeah, it's so what's allowed me to do is really, and with the friends that I'm making on Facebook in Indiana and Arkansas around the country, which is a whole different group of wonderful people and different demographic from inside of the LA area, is that it's reaffirming to me what I want to do for what I call the third stage of my career. And it's the same thing I loved doing when I was a teenager, you know? And what I loved doing as a teenager and child, most of all, was sitting at the piano with or without, you know, a rhythm section, playing songs and playing tunes and making up stuff.
Yeah.
And so all around that, this the drivenness to win the concerto competitions, to get the degree, to get, you know, this job, that job, that was where I put all of this energy into developing expertise.
Yeah.
And these paths have led me to some beautiful, incredible places that, you know, have been really amazing experiences. And but there was always something for me that was still there, kind of under the surface going, you know, your life, Bryan, isn't about an endpoint. It's about a process. What is it? What is the process? And it's taking all of this accumulated, you know, both from a dexterous end to whatever I do with improvisation, which I owe a lot to Richie Byrack. It's a whole other story because Richie was the first guy that I heard play improvise in an atonal style that finally made sense. That was back in 1985, and we hung out. I said, Richie, the first person I ever heard that, he said, well, I really want to improvise it with the integrity that Talk emits who writes his music. And I asked him, I said, this was at Banff. I went to Banff instead of going to graduate school. And I asked him, I said, well, how in control of your choices do you feel you are? And he said, that's a good question. He said, about 85%. And he was honest. And I thought that was a cool answer. Yeah, because, you know, he was really trying. And so I spent that whole year at Banff just taking a metronome and deconstructing everything, just interval to interval, and rebuilding a whole way of improvising, where I suddenly felt that I could be more accountable for my note choices instead of what I was doing prior to that, relying on gesture and avoiding consonants.
I love that. Yeah, I love that.
That always stayed with me. And so what's happened as a result of that, mixed with the technique, is that I go, wow, the taste of people and the sophistication of people of what you would call your normal audience or your big, it's actually pretty deep. I mean, people will, I was thinking, you know, that I kind of did a calculation in my head yesterday saying, you know, about 80% of the range that I'll play is actually attractive to about 80% of a large demographic. So I've had the opportunity for, you know, add up since March through now December, every day of just mixing and matching, turning this style this way, this style this way, playing something in this mood with it, and really being able to two things. Explore how many varieties of aesthetics that can be played, pop stuff, you know, Stevie Wonder stuff, atonal stuff, something really peaceful like that. And then getting the responses from people and going, you know, this is legitimate. So it takes me back to my early childhood, which was, I grew up in a small town in Western PA, we were talking earlier, and I grew up on the south side of a small town, smallish towns, industrial town, Newcastle, Pennsylvania. I mean, you know, I'm really, we have South Side pride and we have Newcastle pride. And there's a lot of great musicians that came from that area, from that city, north. And like I said, and Toby will appreciate this Bernie Dressel grew up 10 miles north of me in Farrell, and we're big football fans too. And I have another Scott Lawton that grew up in our town, who's now, you know, a conductor in Berlin of one of the orchestras. I mean, the great, some people might remember him. One of the first clarinet players that I ever met was on an Animaniac session. And it was Dominic Farah, who passed on some years ago. But Dominic, I said, Dominic, where are you from? He said, oh, Elwood City. And that's 10 miles east of where I grew up. And so Henry Mancini grew up 20 miles. And then, of course, there were all the sports figures. You know, Arnold Palmer, Dan Marino, Joe Montana. Joe Namath grew up in Beaver Falls, which is 5 miles south of where I grew up. So you have these incredibly driven people, whether they're into sports or whether even when they're in whatever field they are, to become the best they can to really kind of get out of there, you know, uh-huh. and make a career.
Yeah.
So the most amazing people. And so I'm going, wow, I could become some, or I am some version of what I always idolized as a child. And what my parents plopped in front of me was, you know, as a 6-year-old, when you're a prodigy in a little town, and you know, at 5 or 6, oh, you're gonna be the next Liberace. Okay, that's the next. So I don't know how many young pianists I've heard, you're gonna be the next Liberace across the country. Probably hundreds of thousands. But that was the model. But then, yeah. The guy that I really liked that was the solo pianist was Peter Nero.
Yes.
Yeah, he had chops, and he blended some cool jazz stuff in his playing, and there were people flocking to his concerts. Mm-hmm. And so I said, that's the guy. And then when I started listening to, now you hear all, you know, George Duke, all the funk guys, you know, Rick Wakeman and Keith Emerson and all these people that were, you know, bringing all of these things together. I was like, oh, he's my hero now. He's my hero. Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh, Chopin. Like Gershwin, you know, when I heard Gershwin, I was, you know, 6 years old. I went down to the basement. My dad was fixing a washer. He said, Dad, can I have $3? And he goes, what do you need $3 for? I said, I want to go buy a copy of the Rhapsody in Blue. He said, oh, here you go. It was a little music. His face lit up. I because you know I never asked that much money from my dad in my life.
That's cute, man.
Yeah,
you really. Know, I have to introduce you. If you don't, I don't think you. Well, who knows? You guys might know each other. Pianist named Rick Helzer.
Rick Helzer. I don't know Rick.
So hi, Rick. Rick used. He's not on here, but he lived. He lived here for a long time, and then he moved to San Diego and became a professor at the university there. And then now he moved back to where he grew up, which is Fresno.
Okay.
And he's an outstanding pianist. You are going to love his playing. And he just recently did a concert in dedication to Richie Bayrak.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Oh, I'm going to have to hook you guys up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll be friends immediately. He's actually going to be on, when is he going to be on? He's going to be on next Monday, actually.
Yeah, Richie and Joe Liebman, those guys, they changed my life. I mean, because what happened when I was at Eastman I did a couple summers in the classical end. What happened at Eastman is I dropped my piano major so that I could play piano more.
Okay.
And the little side story to that is they invited me for an interview in 1992 to be on the faculty at Eastman. And they asked me, well, what would you do with the curriculum? And I told them, well, don't you remember when I was here, I dropped the curriculum? I said, in the arts, curriculum tend to get in the way.
What did they say to that?
Some liked it, some hated it. Yeah, it's the kind of thing that I usually say. I said, I had to drop the curriculum because I already knew how to do X, Y, and Z. So I kept my composition degree. So I didn't have to take sight reading and this repertoire and that. I ended up winning the concerto competition at the end of the 4 years. But I also ended up playing for all the composers. And we had in room 200 for their film scoring sessions, wearing cans and learning how to do that. Did tons of free improvisation, did tons of new music. And I was in a couple of the jazz bands early on. And I still have some good friends from there from when I was a freshman. I mean, that's when I made friends with, I was in awe of Bevan Manson. We're good friends. Bill Cunliffe, who's a great pianist. And other people like that were there. And you know, I'm this little freshman watching these guys playing in Ray Wright's first band and listening to their arrangements. And I was going, holy God, this is amazing. What I did is when I went to Tanglewood for the summers of 83 and 84, I met Gil Kalish, who was he's a pianist, a great pianist, and he teaches at Stony Brook in New York. And it would have been a slam dunk to just go and do graduate work near New York City at Stony Brook and be with Gil and Yehudi Weiner, who's a composition teacher, and to go in that direction to be close to New York. And so I was 20, did I turn 22 yet when I was filling out that application? I don't think I did. But when it came to the full-time student box, I filled it out and I put a check mark in that full-time student box and I stopped in my tracks. This is how I live. And I went, ooh. I literally took the application form, crumpled it up, boom, and threw it in the garbage. And I go, okay, now what? And then I remember a really good musician friend of mine named Mark Stewart, who plays cello and does all kinds of things. I think he's playing guitar now. And I just remember him glowing, about a year before that, saying, oh, you got to check out the Banff Center. You got to check out what they do up there. You go up there, they have no classes. You can work on your projects. It's just a completely free environment. And I remembered Mark's enthusiasm. I went, I'm going to Banff. So I got in under the wire, under the premise that I was.
Excuse me, was Banff just a summer program or was it a?
It started as a summer program in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, maybe. And then they expanded it, I don't know exactly what year, into a year long program of which you could choose to do one semester or another semester or the whole, two semesters, like a regular school program. So I applied for two whole semesters, and that was from 1980, that would be 84 through 85.
And so for those people who don't know, Banff is in Canada, right?
Yeah, B-A-N-F-F. It's, if you think you've seen the Rocky Mountains, you haven't seen them until you see the Canadian Rockies. In Banff, because Calgary is right outside of the Canadian Rockies, and that's the closest biggest city. And then you drive another 40 miles into 60 miles into the Canadian Rockies to the Banff Center.
Yeah,
and the Banff Center.
Who started Banff? I'm sorry to get off on this, but
I don't know. Well,
Banff is really interesting.
Well, the people that I knew that they were there the longest running the music program was Isabel and Thomas Moore. And before that, I don't know, but they may have been responsible for the summer for the winter term program.
I see.
And it was the best decision I ever made because they give you a hut. You have your own piano. They give you, all you have is time and your youthful creative energy. That's all you have.
So some kind of accountability that you have to do?
No, you just, you're there and you're with a lot of other people that are really, really self-motivated. Uh-huh. And you hear each other on concerts and you hear each other at different things. And everybody there that was there, it was incredibly self-motivated, incredibly curious to expand their aesthetics. I met a lot of great Canadian musicians from around the world. And they were working hard because what would happen is it's so beautiful. Banff's Wintertime is known to the greater artistic community, both in jazz and in classical, and even in the metaphysical. I mean, I hung out with Douglas Hofstadter there, which was great. The guy that wrote Gödel, Escher, Bach. And I hung out with some other people like that. But they would love to be guests at Banff because it was so gorgeous. And so there's a wonderful man that ran the Inner Arts program. They started a new Inner Arts program. His name's Michael Century. And Michael Century invited, the year I was there, three jazz musicians that sort of came, dovetailed off one another. Dave Holland came for 3 weeks. We hung out with Dave. I think Richie Bayrak came next. We hung out with Richie, and Dave Liebman came after Richie. And and you know, I hung out with them and just soaked up what they were doing and how they were doing and how they were trying. Those guys, especially Dave Liebman and Richie Bayrak, I saw them as really trying to take accountability for the notes that they were choosing that were extending the language and having it overlap with 20th century languages. So it had that integrity to it. And then that same year, Michael invited for the first a composer, George Crumb. We hung out with a month with George Crumb, played all of his music. Hmm. And the next 3 months, Takemitsu came. And we hung out with Takemitsu for a month and played his music. Huh. Both the nicest guys. And just to be sitting there with Takemitsu, I mean, my God. So it was really a bounty of riches. And really how I got my career started was there was a man named George Coates of George Coates Performance Works in the Bay Area. And he was one of the early theater directors whose productions would have they wouldn't be prescriptive, but they would just have imagery and words that were kind of abstract, but they told a sort of story of the subconscious in all of his performance works. So George Coates Performance Works, and I heard about, well, there's this guy George Coates coming to Banff, and he needed a composer. And nobody wanted to do it. And I was drinking a couple beers with my friend John David, playing pool in the sort of like the rec room. And George was there in the hallway. He said, "Oh, come on, Bryan, just come tomorrow. Maybe you'll like it." I tell you, I went in the next day. I was like, "Oh my God, what this guy is doing on the stage!" Because he took some of the actors, he took some of the singers, and he just had them make up lines, and he had them make up movements, like in the Merce Cunningham way, and he started assembling this narrative, you know. And all I did was sit on the edge of the stage with a DX7 and a 16 inch or 8 inch reel to reel recorder, and I just started playing to everything I saw on the stage, you know, and making up different music that went with different parts, and just storing them and storing them and storing them. And the other thing that the other person that came up that year that was invited by Michael was a Canadian composer from British Columbia named Jean Pichet. And Jean brought up the Fairlight, which was similar to the Synclavier.
Okay. You know?
So, but it's a different version of it. And it was the first time I was introduced to sequencing. And so this Fairlight machine costs multiple thousands of dollars. And I would wake up at 6 a.m. and just go play with the Fairlight and to go, "Oh my God, I can cut and paste. I can take this idea, I can elaborate on it." And And so part of preparing and writing this, writing all the music for George Coates' production also involved using some things that I did on the Fairlight synthesizer as well. And another offshoot of that is that, I always carried cassette machines around with me, cassette players to record myself. Mm-hmm. I said, oh, I could start using the cassette player as a kind of bare bones sequencer. So what I would do is I would improvise and I would play to the cassette player. I would listen back to things and then I would identify the nuggets, the good stuff. And I would write those down on a piece of paper. And then I would take another cassette and I would just play, work with that material. And so I would bootstrap using the cassette machine.
The good old days.
Yeah, basically replicate, you know, sequencing process. It's sort of like, you know, a funneling down process. But make a long story short, George invited me to come out and live with him in the Bay Area. And I was up there. I was up there for a year and a half in 1985 and 1986. And that's where I made a lot of friends there. I made a lot of friends at Mills College. And I still have a lot of friends up there. And then my ex-wife saw a listing in the International Musician sometime in 1985 for a faculty listing, because I knew at school when I wasn't going to get a master's degree, I knew what I was doing. And I knew, you know, I'm rolling the dice, because without the master's minimum, I had basically put myself out of any kind of competition for a college gig, because master's minimum, doctor minimum was kind of standard. Mm-hmm. So I looked at this job, this description for Cal Arts in this would have been the winter of 1986. And they said, we need somebody to do this, 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 period. And my mouth dropped. I couldn't believe what I saw. So I went, this is the connection to throwing that piece of paper away.
Because all of those things you could do.
All those things with no master's minimum requirement.
Oh.
Not even a bachelor's. It just said, and I said, I'm going to apply. I worked my butt off for like 3 months, bumming pianos all over the Bay Area, going to churches, going to schools, taking up all this old repertoire. And I had a friend that was in LA that had a friend inside of Cal Arts that spread the word. And so they actually, I mailed them a preliminary package, and they chose me as four people to audition and interview for them. And I knew that that was going to be my only shot to get from the Bay Area to get to somewhere else where there would be a platform.
Yeah.
And so all I did was practice every day. And I also did a lot of hypnotherapy myself. I would do visualizations and I would see myself in the audition space. And the reason I was doing visualizations at that time was because I treat it a huge amount of anxiety and panic anxiety. So one of the techniques I learned was to do deep guided imagery and visualizations. Yeah. Yeah. So all I did every day was do deep guided imagery when I would take a break at the piano and lay on the pew and see myself in that environment for that hour and make myself feel as comfortable as I could in that environment. And because what I learned through reading about panic attacks and anxiety is that if you start to visualize yourself in the form of as if you were there, you'll reduce your stress when you get there. Yeah. So I've used that technique a lot. Here's all the places I stress out at. Let me just visualize myself being relaxed in those places. Yeah. And it actually works. And I remember even from high school, just reading about self-visualization and the East Germans doing a blind study with basketball. And this is another dovetail, but There was a
you know, by the way, you have to leave little spaces for me to go, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
You're an information roller, man.
Somebody said you should write a book. I say, no, you write it. I don't want to write it.
I'll talk. You write it down.
I'll tell you how this worked. I entered a basketball competition when I was a sophomore in high school. And, you know, me, pianist, I'm not on any basketball team or anything. I took third place in the basketball competition because what I did, as I sat on my, I said, you know, I know about this East German technique. I sat on my kitchen table, this little kitchen table, and I took little paper wads, you know, napkins, rolled them up, and just threw them into the garbage can and made sure they were swishes, you know, really elegantly. And then all I had to do was go to the basketball competition and basically take that image and extend it to meet. Oh, this is how much. So on the first try, my whole body remembered what would be the equivalent of doing that with ease. And I just made about every free throw there. I went swish, swish, swish from practicing.
Well, yeah. I've always felt like anything can be done or solved by being able to look at it, you know, confront it and taking responsibility for it. And that's exactly what you did. And you got familiar with how that feeling is. And you practiced also with the joy. That's what I hear, you know? And so recreating the magic feeling, is how we succeed in the present moment, right?
Absolutely. You know, and what I told my students and what I told myself about that particular interview is my main goal was have them forget that they're actually evaluating you.
Yeah.
And so when I tell people if they're trying out for a competition, I said, make the adjudicators forget for a few minutes that they're evaluating you and that they're enraptured in what you're doing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Those are the ones that stand out.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really a great idea. I remember when I sang one time, I mean, this happened more than once, but I was singing in a rather intimate situation and there was a husband and wife in front of me and the wife was pissed off. Uh-huh. And the husband was, you know, listening. Yeah, so yeah. I decided to really look at the wife and to really flow communication to her and care. And by the end, she loved me. It was great, you know, and I gave her something, you know, I gave her a gift in that moment that she was okay with, you know, and opened up to. So yeah, it kind of goes to why we're doing it, right?
Right.
We want to make that kind of effect on people.
Yeah.
Hey, can we listen to a little bit more music of you?
Sure. What would you like to hear?
I don't know. Let's see. I could go to your Facebook or I could go to YouTube. There seem to be a lot of you on YouTube as well.
Go to YouTube.
Yeah.
Go to Gershwin Medley.
Okay.
Pezzone Gershwin. And then the top one there.
Okay.
This is a this is from a few years back, and this is this is for a cancer charity that I did for a few years. And on this particular performance, it's basically I sort of co-opted the version of the Gershwin medley that I do with Jim Walker in Free Flight. I wanted all Newcastle musicians to be involved. So I only knew one drummer in Newcastle that could be up to the task. And he wasn't even known as a drummer. He was known as Rick, the car insurance, the insurance man. But Rick had gone to Miami, okay? And studied real drumming. And I didn't have any bass player friends around. And so we flew Tim Emmons, my buddy Tim, out to Newcastle. But this is a Gershwin medley that came off pretty well. So.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Yeah. And.
Here we go.
Okay. Thank you.
Amazing. Wow. I didn't realize somebody said, oh, I love Tim Emmons. And then I didn't realize that you had said Tim was playing.
Yeah, Tim.
Yeah. He's such a great guy.
He's my brother. Every time, you know, basically.
I love him. You
know, yeah, I got two cats that are just.
Yeah.
Rhythm section guys or friends of mine that I just stay loyal to, and they stay loyal to me, and they'll go all over the planet, and so will I for them. So
yeah. Hey, I didn't realize. I just never thought about it that the man I love, the theme of it came from that theme, right?
Yeah, right. That's why it's a nice sub to put in.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah. I didn't realize that before.
Yeah.
Such a beautiful theme. It's really beautiful.
Wow.
That was great. That was so interesting to hear you delve into all those different styles and enjoy it. And I noticed your body is so relaxed. Your shoulders are totally relaxed.
I had the best teachers that came along at the right time, because when I started as a baby, I was playing real soft and I was just picking up things by ear. And then I had this, when I went to grade school, there was a lady that was across the street in a Bible study class, and I would hear the hymns in there, and I went and started playing Do Lord, Oh Do Lord, and How Great Thou Art. And this lovely lady, Mrs. Welker, was the pianist, called my dad and said, you got to get him a piano. So he bought a piano for $25, and they hold it down in the trunk, put it in the ring room. And then Mrs. Welker's teacher was Mrs. Stickle. So Mrs. Stickle had me from junior high through high school. And she's the one that started drilling me on scales and arpeggios and bigger repertoire. And I was, at the same time, I was playing in, drunken club bands.
Yes.
Yeah, we were going to Ohio. We were going everywhere. We were playing. So and then one time I took a master class. Somebody came in to town from Germany, Lottie Jacquelin, and I was playing the Italian concerto. And because, when you're really revved up playing, you do all these things with your body that you just have the music in you, but they get in your way. So Lottie Jacquelin, she just worked on the first page of the Italian concerto until I was able to relax my shoulders. And I finally got it. And I went back to Mrs. Stickle when I played the beginning of the Bach Italian concerto for her. She stopped me. She said, I can't teach you anymore. You got to find another teacher. So my high school band director, Tom Zampella, drove me over to the Dana School of Music, which is YSU, Youngstown. And there was a wonderful man there, Robert Hopkins, who was the principal piano teacher. He took me when I was 17. He opened up whole worlds to me. My God, he opened up in terms of music, world of finger independence, world of color. He showed me my first existential writings. He gave me books on this and that. I mean, it was just a feast. I loved working for this man. Huh. And then from there, when I went to Eastman, I ran into a buzzsaw that I needed to run into. And that was an old Italian teacher, Maria Luisa Faini. And so I was playing all this big stuff, and she said, stop. And she said, just drop your hand. Because the last piece that I needed to have put in place was keeping my wrists from getting tight. And so I finally got that, and then I was good to go. So I had the pieces put into place that you really need to be able to play fluently and effectively as a pianist. And it's the opposite of what you might seem. And I always likened it to Buckminster Fuller. I said, if you have the right position, it's like when they talk about batting mechanics, or the mechanics of the pitching. If everything is in the right place and the curves are right, it has this Buckminster Fuller and synergetic effect where you don't have to use as much wasted energy. You only use what you need to, and you release the energy right away. And it's like, you can play all day. And so then the analogy became, because I liked Ellen Watts, the tree blowing in the breeze, your trunk and your core is calm. And this is where it needs to relax physiologically. This is where you need to use, this is where you need to use force. And then the idea of like a hammer of a gun, I would like a bow. You just go to the bottom of the key and you don't push any further. But boom, and in a millisecond, you learn how to relax every little bit of micro tension. And so that's what carried, that's what I started teaching, the yin and the yang of piano technique. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I could do all that stuff and be relaxed, is because I had really, really good teachers that were able to give me exactly what I needed at the right time. Yeah.
Yeah. That's really beautiful. Yeah. That's great. do you know Brad Dudes too?
Oh yeah, I played up at Brad's club a bunch. Yeah. And you know, I know the last thing one of the last things he did up there virtually was with Bernie, but there was one time he wanted to do a concert with me, and then I had a gig come up. I couldn't do it. I regret not being able to do it with Brad, because Brad's just incredible, you know. But he played. There's a composer in San Diego, Chicago, Iverson. She'll put a band together, and she'll include Brad. And so Brad and I have been able to play together, and he's just so dexterous and imaginative, you know, just all at once, you know. it's just incredible.
And that series, I missed that series. That was a really great series going on there.
Oh, and he had to close it. I hope they can open it someday, maybe.
Yeah. he's actually moving to Washington.
Oh, he is?
Yeah, he sold his house.
Washington State, of course.
Washington State, yeah. But he said he'll come back anytime for a gig.
Of course.
So there you go. Yeah. I really am getting more and more into. I mean, I love all kinds of music. You know, I love good music, but I really do like improvisation. And I'm a friend of Stephen Nachmanovich, you know, Free Play. And so, I mean, it's really, I don't know, there's something really valuable and soulful about improvisation, you know.
Yeah.
And so that's why one time I brought Stephen in for to set up some workshops, you know, in this general area. And we went to Idlewild. We brought him up to Idlewild.
Oh, great.
And the workshop was all inclusive of all the different departments. And everybody, all the kids were on stage. And he was standing in the middle. This is how he does it. He just stood there and smiled at everybody.
That's perfect.
And he didn't say a word. And then pretty soon a guitar started playing. And then in a few minutes, all these different people were coming in, the dancers and, you know, it was really wonderful and interesting, you know.
Like watching a flower bed grow or something. Yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
I always made that analogy. Well, there's two analogies I've made with reading and improvisation. I just have simply, people said, well, you know, reading music is like, you know, reading a book, and improvisation is like speaking a language. But deeper than that, when you're at any level, at any style of improvising, you're simply, you know, creating. You're maybe expressing something, and then you're listening to the silences. But the value that I told the classical pianist was that what this does is put you deeply in touch with Beethoven and Bach and Mozart on another level, because they were all phenomenal improvisers. And so this puts you in touch with their creative process. And so by you improvising yourself, you understand what they, you know, and of course Beethoven, Bach and Mozart are different ways of getting to the end product. But I likened it to being on the ground, on the creative ground, with the great composers, and so for Stephen, it sounds like he just created a ground of just silence and presence, and then something would naturally emanate, you know, and that's beautiful. I mean, that's you know, and you can go in any direction with that. What I sometimes do with groups that are starting with improvisation like that, I'll say, now let's build in intentional silences, because people tend to fill up spaces. And then a lot of times people, the group as a whole, which is natural, tends to fall into a rhythmic pattern. And so the second level I'll add to that is say, okay, I just want people to just stop, and I want you to listen to your little, to what the texture sounds like without your sound in it. So it's kind of listening to what is removed. And now I want everybody to remove themselves more and more so that suddenly there's a spontaneous 10 seconds of nothing. And so to build backwards like that in the group is interesting.
That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I don't know if you know, but I have a 7-piece a cappella improv group called.
Oh my God. 7-piece.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's called, Fish to Birds. And
Fish to Birds is. Oh.
Yeah, we got that name from one of the Escher paintings, you know.
Yeah. Right? No, I love Escher. Yeah.
And we've been together about 8 or 9 years.
Oh my
God. I really miss singing with them because you can't really get the same effect on Zoom, you know. And we do a lot of really beautiful things. And when we get together to rehearse, it's not really rehearsing, right. Just get together to sing. We work on different things. And sometimes rhythmic, sometimes harmonic, sometimes just kind of ideas of form, you know.
Sure. Yeah, you could focus on any parameter you want and sort of hone it and go deep and then get a sub parameter going and go into that. And then you could take it back out and say, okay, well, there's always this thing that I call the proximity effect with, because I like science and quantum physics too. So the proximity effect is, I basically reduced and being an artist and being a musician to a simple formula. Because in our culture and all, I mean, we have the luxury of being artists, but I said, you know, people in their offices, whatever, they work. And then they're given this weekend time to play. When it's nighttime, I said, here's my model of life. Play, work, play. Not the other way around. So, and the proximity effect is this, you play, and part of that play is taking things. Well, no, actually I'll restate that. There's the play, and then the work part is to take things from the play and to sort of work on them the way you were talking about. Mm-hmm. And then the proximity effect tells you that the very next thing you do when you're in the spirit of play again, uh-huh, will be biologically and unconsciously informed by the work that you just did. So it'll carry over into a spirit of play. And so if you bootstrap that idea, play, work, play, play, work, play, play, work, play, it's a never-ending spiral that continues through life. And so I like that idea, play, work, play, work, play. And I like the idea of work being identifying something and then applying some sort of strictures on it and working on it. Yeah.
That's really nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a very, very direct, simple, beautiful way to think.
Well, you know, reductionism is great if you reduce it to the right thing. Reductionism really sucks if you're off target.
Yeah, that's really nice, though. I love that. Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, a lot of, yeah, you're right. People look at that backwards.
I know. If you start from someone else's reduction, oh my God, it could be monstrous. and that brings us full circle back to identity when we started this conversation.
Yeah, yeah. Oh yeah.
About the name. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, really interesting.
Yeah.
You already told me so much that it's like I mean, I know a few people who work at CalArts, and how long have you worked there?
Well, you know, I started in 87, then I left in 2000.
Oh.
And then I was with the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra from the early 90s through 99. And basically what happened is I got divorced without kids, and my whole life changed. What I basically wanted was, I didn't want to have a boss. So I quit the Hollywood Bowl. I quit CalArts. I didn't have the marriage. And I just kind of just flew out there on a limb. And so since 2000 through now, and basically 2018, 19, 2015, it's just been riding out this beautiful, messy, you know, kind of journey of whatever comes, you know, both personally and musically. And there were a couple times where there were a couple, like I said, I was interviewed by Eastman for a gig there. And Bob Freeman, who's just the greatest dean in the world, called me up and said, well, what do you think? I said, well, I like California. My wife doesn't want to move. There were a couple gigs that were advertised as crossover gigs at a couple big schools, UCLA and the Frost School in Miami.
Yeah.
And I pulled out of both of those. And the last time I pulled out of it was at U of M, because that was a serious invitation. And I had to really do some soul searching. And the soul searching turned into the form of, I was driving on a Santa down on the 22. It was a Sunday night and I was playing some grad composer's piece. And I saw these trees, the palm trees were just going, and I'm unbuttoned and I'm going, wow, this is so beautiful. I have to pull that application. I just can't dress up and be, you know, after you're at some place like Kell Arts, I couldn't go into a more structured place and be that kind of person in those environments. I could come in and give a class and talk about the things that I talk about, which I've done. So what I stuck out there, and this is the only thing that proves the power of intention. this one time I was in Fresno, again in Fresno, or maybe it's for a flute workshop as part of the California State School of the Arts. So all these, you know, I think Robert Dick was there and a number of other great flutists, because my ex-wife was a flutist, that's how I met Jim. But they all asked me, and even when I came back, why aren't you teaching somewhere? Why aren't you teaching somewhere? This was in the summer of 2016. And I kept repeating the same answer. The same answer. I must have repeated this answer about 100 times within 2 weeks. I said, well, I've decided that if I'm going to be affiliated somewhere, I want to be asked. I don't, because I knew I didn't have it in me to beat the audition that I did in 1987 at CalArts. I didn't have it in me. I know what it took. They asked me, they shortlisted me on the LA Phil gig when Zita Carno left. And I told the contractor, I said, Roy, I said, no, I can't. I'm just quitting things. I'm not joining things. And I also knew my colleagues who were working very, very hard to win that job. And I was going, well, if I can't play better than them, I'm not going to do it anyways. So I passed on that. So what eventually reduced down to was, I want to be asked. I want to be asked for specifically what I do, which is this crossover thing. And it would be a nice bonus if it were a brand new program, you know, that way, you know, it was from the ground up, and it wasn't sort of infected with, you know, an aesthetic, you know, either through time or through European, American, whatever. Yeah. So I get home after this, I'm out to dinner, I get a phone call, and it's from my friend, you probably know Kate. She's a great jazz pianist, and a great pianist and musician, Kate Dutton.
Oh yeah, sure.
So I get this message on the phone, and I'm by the way, I was eating. I don't think you were. I was eating at Cal de Sol. Okay.
Okay. All right.
With Cal de Sol. All right. So I listen to this message. Hi, Brian. This is Kate Dutton. We're starting a brand new piano program here at Los Angeles College of Music, and I need somebody to come in to be a crossover pianist. And and your name kept coming up. I asked around, would you like to join? And I called her back. I said, hi, Kate, it's Bryan. I said, yes. She said, you serious? I said, of course. You know, it's not about a money thing. It's not about being, you know, the grand poobah at some grand poobah place.
Yeah.
My work that I do there is minimal because it's kind of specific, you know. But it's nice to be affiliated with a bunch of great musicians at a place like that, where on the piano faculty you got a guy like Mitch Foreman, right?
Yeah.
and me, and we have Lisa Harrington now. She took over the program.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and what happened is I toured a lot with Mike Packer and with Ralph Humphries. I met Ralph Humphries on Animaniacs in a studio before I knew that Ralph was the original Mothers of Invention. And so what Kate had done was called all these musicians that were in this different, that were friends of mine, you know, and they all said, you know, she called like Jeff Stradlin. She called, they said, call Bryan, because I had a, because they were able to look beyond how I soiled my own reputation on Facebook by letting it all hang out there for the studio world to see. there's the plus, you know, when I look at it, there's the flip, the good side, and there's always a trade-off. It's like, well, you know, if I didn't put this out there, then this wouldn't happen. So these were all friends of mine, and you know, and the faculty and administration is super cool. They're letting me take the year off because, like I said, we had a Zoom meeting. They're still continuing through with those small ensembles, but I just can't do it on Zoom the way I was doing it.
Yeah. You know, I work there too.
You do.
I mean, I work on and off. I was working for a while. I think I got the gig at Idlewild for a year to teach at Idlewild, and so I stopped that because basically I was out of town for 3 days every week at Idlewild, and so then I kind of came back on and off, and I'm still, you know, part of the staff, but it's more off than on. But I have there was one time where I was for a semester I was the singing teacher for the two different ensembles, and one was Mitch Foreman and one was Steve. Is that his name? Steve. Yeah. Steve, the bass player. He's a really cool guy. Anyway, he teaches very straight ahead, good stuff to learn, you know? So you'd go in, you'd
not hear Jerry Watts, the other.
No. Steve, Pendleton. Gilman. Anyway. So I go in, it was kind of straight, but it was all the really good information, you know, real basic. Then I go over to Mitch's class.
Yeah.
Same song. He's like, yeah, let's do it like Brazilian 12-8, you know, and the students were like, oh, okay, you know. And it was great, actually. It was really, and it was fun to actually see that within 2 hours, experience that, you know. It was really cool.
For me, it's kind of ideal it's an ideal affiliation because, you know, it's kind of like you have a new home with colleagues that you know, but you're basically still operating as a freelance artist and your own artist affiliated with a place that is kind of like a hub rather than being subsumed by. And I think that's a really beautiful combination.
I think that's cool. I mean, I was at Musicians Institute.
Yeah.
So, which, you know, part of it broke off and became LA College of Music. So I've always liked that creation, you know, of pulling together professional musicians and creating the staff out of that, you know. And I just think it's a great idea. Yeah. And LA College of Music remains small and has a lot of international, you know, students. Yeah, it's a cool, and David Joyce is the head of the vocal department, and he's really cool.
Yeah. And different people, you know, what I really like about the administration is they, up all the way up and down the chain, they allow you to do what you want to do and what your strengths are.
Yeah.
And instead of forcing, you know, say, no, well, you have to do this, 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 and this. And having that kind of relationship with an administration in terms of what's expected or else, you know, it doesn't exist there. And so it makes it very, very easy, and it makes it a nice environment. Yeah.
Yeah, that's so cool. Yeah. Well, you know, we're almost at the 2-hour mark.
Wow. I knew we'd get there fast.
Well, it's so much fun to talk, you know, and to, you know, kind of ride the wave of where it takes you. And you have so much information and so many experiences that are really interesting. And I never even said to you, oh, and how did you grow up? I never said that at all. You know, I never asked you, you know, about, you know, things like that. So, yeah it's been really enjoyable to talk. And
I really appreciate you inviting me, Cathy. We've circled around each other over, you know, 30 or so years, and or 20 or whatever.
I know. It's amazing.
I have always loved hearing you. I mean,
oh, thank you. Thank you.
So my favorite. I was like, oh, it's Cathy Segal-Garcia. We got to stay. It was always that. We got to stay.
Oh, yeah. That's cool to know. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, it's the truth.
Well, you know, as usual, you know, I when I talk to people and I discover their music, I, you know, usually I'm enthralled, and I'm enthralled with your music, and I'm going to tap in. Well, it's always on your Facebook anyway, but I'm just curious, what time do you do your morning and evening?
Oh, it could be anytime, because I live in an apartment building. I usually start, I don't play too loud until 10 o'clock, and then I'll stop around 10 p.m. or 9 p.m. So,
okay.
And it's whenever I feel like it.
Okay.
And then sometimes I'll put up, you know, an event, and I'll advertise it. Sometimes I'll advertise it a half hour before.
Yeah.
But then one of the groups I'm actually doing on December 14th, and Veronica Ebert is part of this group. It's called the Co-Gig, or Giving Back. And they literally have scheduled 500 or more musicians around the world slotted one after another. A gentleman named Mike Manley, and we're going to break the Guinness's World Book of Records, because it's going to be the largest music event with 500 running over 19 days.
Wow.
And I have my hour slot on there, which is December 14th at 3 p.m. Eastern time. That's my next thing. I'm so grateful to be part of that.
Will that be up on your Facebook so people can find it?
Yeah, just like you saw me tag you a billion times here for this.
I'll
do the same thing. Yeah.
All right, good. Well, you know, I'm going to say a few things of me too. I'm actually giving a scat workshop. I haven't given too many workshops during this time. Just, I don't know why, I just haven't really desired to create it. So that's December 19th, which is a Saturday. You can find this on my website. But scat, maybe I should say improv too, you know, because I like to, it would be nice to not just concentrate on kind of direct scat, but some improv too, seeing as our discussion, you know, talking about that. And then you're going to laugh at this, but there's so Sunday, December 13th, there's a really great singer and a great business person.
Okay.
And she created a wonderful site for those of you who are interested, called Jazz Voice, either .com or .org. And she has invited probably 15 high level jazz singers to be kind of her teachers. And so they give private lessons through it, and also workshops. And it's very inexpensive to be a member and to have, you know, gain entrance into all of these. And I'm just a special workshop clinician. And so that is Sunday evening at 6 o'clock Pacific time. But what I'm going to be teaching is how to create community,
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah, so she actually asked me to do that subject, you know, which is basically creating venues and creating things that tie people in together, because that's what I do.
Oh, you're
and
good.
Yeah. Yeah, so going to do that. And then I have a gig. I have a gig. And it's only going to be streaming. It's from the LA Athletics Club. Okay. And that is December 10th, coming right up. It's Thursday night. And at from 5, let's see, is it 7 to 9 or 5 to 7? It's 7 to 9. And I created the band, which is going to be really fun. I've worked with Atmara Ruiz on piano.
Oh, yeah.
Carrie Frank on B3.
Yeah. Carrie's that's fantastic. Good guy.
We did that a gig together, and it was one of my favorite ever gigs because it had the groove and it had the adventure. And then we're adding Aaron Seferty on drums.
Yeah, whatever.
So that's going to be really fun. So that's what's coming up for me, actually, right in just these next few weeks.
That's a great, great, great group. Wow. I can sort of hear it.
And then just to tell you, and you'll be interested, at least in the Wednesday. So tomorrow, my guest is Stephanie Nikazian, and she's a really swinging singer. She was married to a bebop piano player named Hod O'Brien, who was pretty well known in bebop circles. And her daughter is Veronica Swift. So she's, you know, the super, super up and coming jazz singer now. And so she's on tomorrow. And then Wednesday, I don't know are you into Brazilian music at all?
Love it. Yeah.
Well, I discovered this amazing piano player who's been at it for years named Benjamin Tobkin.
Okay. Don't know Benjamin.
He's gorgeous player. Oh my God. And he's really, you know, I mean, he's had a long, long career. So I'm really looking forward to speaking with him too.
Yeah.
So that's the rest of this week. So we started with Bryan. Thanks for being on. It was really fun. And I feel like we should do it again because there's a lot more information to be had.
Yeah, and you know, I love talking about it. And each time I talk about things, you know, I basically say the same things, but they will actually coalesce in new ways too. You know, even the expression of ideas.
Yeah, definitely.
Organization, yeah.
It would be fun to have, although I probably would be like a fly on the wall, but it'd be fun to have you and Bevan on together.
Oh my God.
Because he was really fun too. He was full of information and, you know, he's very gregarious, you know.
Bevan, I get a bless, you know, when he was at Eastman and I was at Eastman, he was the only one that didn't lay, you know, the jazz canon trip on me, because he was Bill Dobbins' assistant and he had a class and he was so kind, you know.
He's kind.
He's like, oh, okay, just, you know, maybe avoid that. But he wasn't like, you know, whatever that movie was, about the drummer.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God. Yeah. Ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bevan is kind. You're right. He's so kind. In fact, I've known him for years and years, but every time I talk to him, part of me always is amazed by that. You know, he's so kind.
He's kind. And I don't know anybody else. I know, I'll put him in my top five of people that I know are just absolutely in love with music 24/7.
Yes.
Yeah. So.
Yes. Really great.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it would also be very interesting to have you and Brad on, because Brad is also like super. It's funny because I've been friends with these people for a long time, you know, working with them a lot, and never had a 2-hour conversation. Him and Nick Mancini was really deep, and Anthony Wilson was really deep. And, you know, it was just in people. I wasn't that surprised by John Clayton, because I thought, oh, John Clayton's going to be deep. But yeah, Nick Mancini kind of blew my mind. It was like, wow, anyway, 2-hour conversations is really a nice thing. So thank you for being very generous with that.
Well, thank you, Cathy, for being generous to invite me.
Okay, I'm going to see you online. I'm going to ask you questions offline. So, because I have,
okay.
I'm curious about something. But thanks. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day.
You too.
And I'll see you later.
Okay. I'll see you later, and everybody.
Okay. Bye, everybody. Thank you for coming. And hopefully, I'll see you tomorrow. Okay. All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.